Hello everyone, my name is Mourad Cherfaoui. I'm a cloud solutions architect at Intel, and my focus at Intel is developing and architecting solutions to expose Intel hardware security features to higher layers of software like cloud orchestration and cloud native. Thanks.
Hello everyone, my name is Joseprabu in Inbaraj. I go by Jose. I lead cloud solutions school at AMI. We at AMI provide the core foundational technologies for the compute platform, right from boot firmware to BIOS, and then security solutions as well, from headshot firmware to attesting platform attestation software. Personally, I have extensive experience in platform management, security across telco, hyperscale, and IoT segments. I hold around 30 plus patents across different technology areas. And here I'm here today to share our experience in terms of security. Awesome, thank you. So let me start the agenda. We already spoke about who we are, so I'm going to skip that page. We'll talk about the problem that we are trying to discuss today, right? The problem statement. And then we will explain some use cases around it. And we will introduce the concept of confidential computing, you know, what it is, why it's needed, things like that, what it provides, the benefits, et cetera, et cetera. And then we will touch upon the attestation aspect of the confidential computing, right? Why it's needed, what it is, who are all the different parties and things like that. And then we will conclude, we will have a tie all these things together and explain a use case on how confidential computing works and addresses a specific use case. I'll pick one and explain. And then we will conclude with few takeaways. Yeah. So let me move on. This is our intro page. Now we both explain ourselves, so I'll skip this. So let's start with the problem statement, right? What are we trying to solve? What is it that we are worried about? Yeah. So this is a statement, right? Your data security is one of the main barriers for cloud adoption, right? This is a survey result from Cloud Security Alliance, a nonprofit group. This has been more historically, but though it is being solved, though it's being addressed, it's still, even now, it is still one of the top reasons for cloud adoption, right? If you talk to me, if let's say you as a customer, if you are onboarding or if you are loading one of your workload, whether it's a VM or container or anything on a public cloud, are you confident, are you assured that it is safe, right? It is secure, that even the cloud administrator or and anybody else, the co-person, are they having access to my data? Is my data secure from anybody, right? Including the infrastructure managers, right? That's the key question, right, that we are trying to solve today, yeah? So what's the landscape of the security, right? The sensitive data. If I need to protect my sensitive data, what are all the landscapes that I should worry about, right? What are the different things? The first thing is at rest, right? Data at rest. This is when you store your data in a storage, in a cloud or in your local enterprise server, wherever it is. What do you do now? How do you secure that? There are solutions, there are options. We have been addressing this and it's there, right? You just encrypt the data and store it. And there are many mechanisms. If you want to protect your keys, then there are solutions for KMS where your keys are safely saved in a vault so that at rest, nobody can break it. Even if somebody has access to it, it's not raw, it's encrypted, it's protected. So that's secure. Now, how do you do in transit? This is when you move your data from point A to point B. Yeah. The point A could be your enterprise network and the point B could be the cloud. So when you send your data from A to B, how do you protect your data when it is in transit? Again, industry has several solutions, right? And a few of things that we all know, things like HTTPS, SSH TLS, they all encrypt the data when it is stuff, and hence it's secure, right? There are also other options like the protected tunnels, VPN, where the whole tunnel, the pipeline is protected, and then you are securing the data when it is in use, right? When your code, when your program, when your data is being executed, when it's being consumed by the CPU, when it's in the RAM, is it secure? How do you secure it? That's the scenario that we're going to talk about, right? There's not been a focus historically, but recently many vendors are addressing this problem. They're coming up with solutions. and we'll talk about more detail about it. This is the RAM attack exposure that we will deal with. So the ultimate goal, what's the goal? We want to protect our sensitive data in all three states, right? Not just at rest or not just in transit. We also want to protect when it's used. That's the goal, right? If you don't protect in all three states, then you are compromising the security of your sensitive data, right? So that's the goal that we want to achieve. We are going to start with. So what are all the concerns as a cloud tenant or as an edge tenant? What are the concerns I have, right? The number one question that I will ask is my secret still remain a secret? Does it remain secret, right? Is it safe? Is it invisible or is it unencryptable to the others, right? That's one question. The other questions that I may ask is the right program being executed, right? You might be executing something in the cloud, you might be thinking that you're running a role. Is it your workload that's getting executed or is it getting compromised? And even if it is the program, is it doing the things that it's supposed to do, right? Or is it being compromised, right? Is it the same version that you already uploaded? So how do we, these are the questions that I ask, right? We should ask when we are using a cloud, right? Is our data secure? Is it still a secure? What are all the major concerns that I will be worried about, right? As you can see in this slide, I just listed in a few. There are many, but these are the top few that I can think of, right? Malicious privileged admins, right? So this is basically an intentional hack, right? If your VM is in a cloud or you know any other third-party cloud, a malicious admin can just snapshot the VM and just use it, right? There are many ways that it could be compromised, yeah? And how do you protect your workload or your sensitive data from such malicious admins, right? Even if there is no malicious admins, it can be a unintended attack as well, right? I, as an admin, may not be malicious. I might be saving your, taking a snapshot, but if my infrastructure is compromised, let's say, right? So the compromised infrastructure is the next thing. If the infrastructure where my workload is running, if that is compromised, how do I protect myself, right? Is my data secure, right? The infrastructure could be hardware, right? The actual platform where it's running, or it could be the software layer, including the hypervisor that's running my workload or the container that's Kubernetes kind of things that's running my container, right? So how do I deal with a compromised infrastructure? The other party is unintended access, third-party access like hacked accounts where your data gets compromised without your consent. Your data is getting accessed by somebody else. Now, it could be another VM that's running there, another workload running there. So how do you protect yours from such attacks, right? So this is what we are dealing with, okay? Now I will let Mourad talk about the others and the scenarios, what are the current solutions that we have right now, and he will touch upon the cloud confidential computing and such. Mourad?
Thank you, Charles. Thank you. So when it comes to the sensitive data protection, one of the features of operating systems and hypervisors is to protect applications and data. They have mechanisms to do that, right? But operating systems and hypervisors are also software, right? And software, as we know, can have vulnerabilities, right? So these vulnerabilities can help or can allow an attacker or a malicious agent to access the data, right? And as Jos mentioned, there is still a threat of a malicious administrator, right? Who can access, for example, sensitive data by doing a VM snapshot. There is also poor operational operations, right? Where even if an administrator makes a legitimate VM snapshot, for example, if the VM snapshot is not adequately protected, then secrets or sensitive information can leak out, right? And there is also the class of physical attacks, right? Basically, attackers who have access to the hardware. Okay, so we talked about protection, data protection through virtualization, and probably We have heard about hardware assisted virtualization, right? Technologies provided by both Intel and AMD, where virtualization is supported by hardware instructions. So those provide an additional layer of protection, but they have not been designed to isolate applications from each other. That was not the initial goal, right? And those instructions are still used by software, and software, as we mentioned, is susceptible to vulnerabilities, right? That can be exploited by attackers. Okay. So what is the solution? So the solution is basically to have the ability to protect or to keep the sensitive data and the code that processes the data in an isolated area on a server or a host. That isolated area, we call it a trusted execution environment, or TEE for short. So that isolated area of execution is isolated from anything else running on a host. So this is how we can address the concern of protecting sensitive data in use. Okay. So as we have seen, trusted execution environment, this is the key concept here, TEE, allows to protect sensitive data through hardware means, as we will see, and then also to ensure that the code operating on that sensitive data is also has kind of integrity protection. Is basically the code that is expected to run on the data, which is something that is desirable, especially in cloud or edge contexts. Okay, so before we talk about TEEs, there are some design principles whenever a TEE is used that are good to keep in mind. So first, a TEE, or Trusted Execution Environment, is only useful if it has a way to communicate with the outside world, right? So that's we will call that the interface, the communication interface. So basically, that's how the rest of the world can communicate with that TEE. So everything inside the TEE is protected. And the only way to get into or to have the TEE do something useful is through that communication interface, right? So that communication interface should be very hardened, right? Because if it's poorly designed, then secrets can be extracted from the TEE, either because maybe the interface provides maybe means to extract the data directly, or maybe the data can be inferred by calling maybe a number of APIs in that interface, right? So it's very, very important that that interface gets full attention when a TEE is implemented. Another design principle is to keep the TEE as small as possible, because the bigger the TEE, the more chances for vulnerabilities to occur. So TEE, whatever you run in the TEE is still software. So a good design principle is to keep it that TEE as small as possible, whenever possible, of course. Okay. So the concept of trusted execution environment is actually not new, but so there have been TEEs in use, you know, for a long time, right? But probably not known under or not designated under that name, TEE, right? So some of the names here that are listed here, that you have probably seen, HSM, KMS, TPM, BMC. These are actually all examples of TEEs, right? So we'll go through some of them. So first, an HSM. HSM is hardware security module. So an HSM is basically a device that is attached to a host. And an HSM stores cryptographic keys, in particular, very sensitive cryptographic keys, like private keys, for example. And HSMs are able to do cryptography inside the HSM, right? So keys never need to be in RAM, right? Because they are kept inside the HSM, and the cryptography is also done inside the HSM. So the keys are protected at all time when they are in use, right? And the interface that is used for the HSM-TEE is typically PKCS 11. That's kind of the standard API that is used for HSMs. KMS is another example. So key management systems are usually, the typical use is to retrieve keys from key management, from a remote key management system, and use them on the host. But KMS also can be instructed to perform cryptographic operations directly inside the key management system. So in effect, there are kinds of TEE, since the sensitive data, the keys in this case, and the processing is done separately from where the host is, right? Other examples of existing TEEs are TPMs, Trusted Protection Module. So these are used in the context of trusted boot, basically ensuring that the server booted in the expected state, where all the layers of software and firmware are the ones that are expected. So TPMs are also hardware devices that are usually attached to the motherboard, and they come with built-in RSA keys, and they also support cryptographic algorithms. So all the processing that is done to ensure that the server or host booted in a trusted state is done inside that TPM. So in essence, it is a kind of TEE. BMC is another example, board management controller. Basically, this is also a hardware device that gets attached to the host on the motherboard, and allows an administrator to do management of the host out of bed without using the kind of the regular data channel, right? And BMCs are in essence devices with their own CPU, microcontroller, and it's their own RAM. So they are TEEs as well. However, what we are interested in are TEEs, technologies that can allow us to run generic code, right? Any code, basically. So these are specifically called programmable TEEs. So programmable TEEs are basically technologies that allow you to run user code inside and protect it inside the TEE, right? Unlike HSM, TPM, or BMC, which have dedicated functions, and on top of that, they require separate hardware, right? So we are also interested in technologies that can support trusted execution environment natively without requiring a separate hardware, right? So these would be technologies that are supported natively in the CPU, right? And the reason we want this feature is so that we can, for example, do things like scaling, right? If we wanted to scale the TEE, we can do that because it's all supported in CPU, and also because the TEE would be in most cases like regular software that can be deployed the same way as any other software. It can be upgraded, etc. Okay, so now we will see some sample TEE use cases. We have seen some TEE use cases, like for example for key protection with HSMs and board management with BMC. But there are actually, when thinking about it, there are actually many instances where trusted execution environment are needed, right? So the examples are, a few examples are listed here. This is not an exhaustive list, and some of them, or at least one of them, we will detail in the next slides. But TEEs have been extensively used in AI, in artificial intelligence, right? Both in building models and in inference, right? Once the model is born. And the reason you want to use TEEs for AI, both in, again, in generating models and inference, is because AI uses large data sets that contain potentially privacy related information, right? Like PII, for example, right? And you don't want that PII to be available on public clouds, for example, right? You might want to protect it, right? So still use all that large amounts of data, but have the ability to protect it. Another use case is confidential deep packet inspections. So this is basically where you kind of you use a network node to inspect encrypted traffic. So typically you need to decrypt the traffic. So the payload at that time would be in clear text in RAM, right, where it's being analyzed. With a trusted execution environment, you can do the same thing in a TEE, which allows the device to parse the traffic and look for attack signatures while preserving the privacy of the traffic, right? Confidential cryptocurrency, that's another usage scenario for TEEs, so with blockchains. Fraud detection is another example where you wanna, for example, in insurance, if there is a case of fraud without having privacy related information of maybe individuals in RAM, right? And all these use cases have been kind of used in all these vertical security, financial, healthcare, insurance, etc. So we look at one usage scenario in a little bit more detail. So that's what we call confidential AI for healthcare, right? So in healthcare, where you have all these kind of large amount of data available for learning, right? Like for example, for medical diagnostic. But the problem there is that you have patient's data, like at the end of the day, patient's data that kind of you need to use and infer. So healthcare organizations have been reluctant to share those types of data because of privacy concerns. So it turns out with a TEE that can be done, and data can be shared by institutions and used for learning. And there have been successful examples of usage, for example, in brain tumors. So in one instance, detection increased, for example, by more than 11% because the people who were building the models had access to more data, right? And solutions have been developed by both UCSF and University of Pennsylvania as well. I think we'll skip this one and then, okay. So now confidential computing. So for the rest of these slides, we give more formal definitions of confidential computing. We use the definitions that are available on the Confidential Computing Consortium website. So this is a website that has a lot of good information on confidential computing. It's good to bookmark if you are interested. So the confidential computing is basically the umbrella concept whenever you use a trusted execution environment, that's basically doing confidential computing, right? So it's protection of data in use by performing computation, as we have seen in a hardware-based trusted execution environment. So that's very important, the hardware part of it, because as we have seen, software can always be defeated. Right, and I'll skip some of those definitions here. So what are the trusted execution environment properties as defined by the confidential computing concept? So first, the data confidentiality, as we have seen, this is a key point. So you want first and foremost to have your confidential data kept confidential when they are in use, right? This is kind of the in-use part of the data landscape that we have seen in the beginning. Data integrity, basically you want to keep the data, or preserve the integrity of the data in your trusted execution environment. And also another property of TEEs is code integrity. Basically you want to make sure that the code that you are running that is operating on your sensitive data is the one that you expected. So that's the code integrity. Okay. And then there are additional TEE properties, and those additional TEE properties are defined by uh, by actually specific technologies, are implemented by specific technologies. So just go through some of them. Programmability is basically, we discussed this. So this is the ability to run generic software in trusted execution environment, unlike HSMs and TPMs that are more like focused or have a different fixed basically function, a dedicated function, right? Attestability, this is Joss will detail there in the next slides. And then this property also can be imported in some context where you want the code also to be kept confidential, not just the data, right? So that some TE technologies provide that support. Okay, so in order to protect data in use, confidential computing is actually not the only technique. So we see here in the in this diagram at the bottom, there is all this class of solutions, trusted execution environments. This is where confidential computing is. And then trusted execution environments, you have there are hardware-based TEEs that are programmable. So these are the ones that we are focusing on today. There are TEEs that are not programmable, like TPMs, and also there are TEEs implementation that are like implemented in software. But this is the class of trusted execution environment solution. But there are other, good to know that there are other solutions to protect data, like homomorphic encryption, where basically you do the processing is done without having or needing to decrypt the data, right? So the technology exists and, you know, it's still maturing, but it's there. And another solution is multi-party computation, where basically multiple parties collaborate in solving in working on pieces of the data, not the entire data, and only the data owner has the end result. Right? Okay. So how can we like a TEE is, as we have seen, an isolated unit of execution. So when we say unit of isolation, what is this unit of isolation? So it can be virtual machine, it can be a process, or it can be a single or group of related functions, right? Okay, so these are the unit of isolations that we have discussed. Again, function, process, and virtual machines, and then we can move to examples of programmable TEE technologies that are in use today, right? So so there is Intel software card extension, SGX, and the unit of isolation is the functional level or library and also process. AMD, AMD SEV is another technology that allows to have programmable TEEs, and the unit of isolation is a VM. ARM Trust Zone, so this is kind of the technology that is used on mobile devices, and also AWS Nitro Enclaves is another technology. Okay. Now, how is, you know, you might wonder how can we implement trusted execution environment in regular CPUs, right? So there are three general classes of implementation solutions for TE. Basically to implement the technology itself. So either you can, the RAM can be encrypted by CPU. So the RAM used by the trusted execution environment can be encrypted by the CPU and only decrypted inside the CPU, right? So this is how you can basically implement a RAM. You can implement it through hardened VM isolation, like as the case with AWS Nitro Enclaves, or like some hardware, dedicated hardware, like for example with ARM Trust Zone, right? So here we'll see how the implementation via trusted execution environment with encryption decryption works. So basically, the trusted execution environment still runs in RAM, right? You don't have an additional RAM, but as the content of the TE is loaded, it's encrypted by the CPU, right? By a key that is inside the CPU package, right? And at execution time, when the data and the instructions are sent to the CPU package, they are decrypted inside the CPU package. So the data in the trusted execution environment can't be seen by anyone on that host, right? And also when they are transferred to the CPU, same thing. It's all encrypted, and it's only the data and the code is only visible inside this language. Okay, so now how can we build or generate trusted execution? How can you build like software for trusted execution environment? So that depends on the technology. So most technologies will provide like an SDK that will allow a developer to build his own kind of binary that will end up in a trusted execution environment. There is also an initiative called Open Enclave, where basically this is a set of APIs and SDK that is hardware agnostic or solution agnostic rather. So basically, as a developer, you can use the Open Enclave SDK, and then the SDK is the one that will kind of like make the mapping to the target TEE technology. And I think, Jos, back to you for the TEE attestation.
Thank you, Mourad. Thank you so much for covering what confidential computing is and TEE, the Trusted Execution Environment, and the various properties, right? So let's touch upon the attestation property of the TEE. What it is, why do we need things like that? So what is the attestation? Why do we need it, right? So the core concept, that the key problem that we are trying to address is how do you trust, how do you secure your data, right, when it's used? Now, if you are betting on, if you're depending on the trusted execution environment, how are you assured that the TEE is not compromised, right? It is what it is. How do we ensure that? That's where this attestation part comes in, yeah? So what is attestability? The TEE, the trusted execution environment, it needs to provide evidence, right? It could not be the current state, but it should provide an evidence that can be verified by a verifying party, right? Who can measure and tell whether this TEE can be trusted or not, right? Now, one point that we need to consider is this evidence needs to be signed by hardware, which again should be vouched by the manufacturer. That way you are assured that the evidence is not compromised, because again, it's possible that a malware or an unauthorized party can compromise the TEE and emulate the responses. So to ensure that it is intact, the evidence should be verified, should be signed by hardware that is vouched by a manufacturer, like a key or a hardware key or something like that. So that's very, very important. Yeah. So what are all the different parties involved in TEE attestation? Again, we took it from the RATS terminology, the remote attestation work group, which is as part of IETF. These are all the five parties. There are more, but these are all the five core parties that are involved in a TEE attestation, right? So there is evidence, which we talked about. It's a signed structure. Again, it should be signed. It should be only generated by a hardware from the TEE, right? It should be, hardware manufacturer should be able to vouch for this evidence. So that's the core root of trust for us, right? That's one thing. The relying party, this is the party, or this is the application or the user who is relying on TEE to run their secure code or to host their secure data, right? So that's the client application, or the role that's played by the application of the system that's using it, right? That's the relying party. Yeah? That's the party that needs the assurance that the TEE is safe and secure or can be trusted. Now the attester, that's the role, that's again the TEE, or there could be a proxy of the TEE as well, right? Who is providing the evidence, that's the attester. And the verifier is the system or the role that actually gets the evidence and verifies and tells you whether it's trustable or not, right? That's the verifier, which will give the results to the relying party. And the attestation results are, again, it can be a simple pass or fail, or it could be another combination of structure that tells what the trust state is, right? And again, it's a good practice to send the attestation result in a signed form so that it is not compromised, right? So what are the possible attestation flows? There are many, okay? So I'm going to talk about these three. So the top one that you see is the simpler of the form, right? Where the attester sends the evidence to the verifier or relying party. In this scenario, both the verifier and the relying party are the same systems. So the interaction is very simple, right? So the attester sends the evidence. The user, the verifier or relying party, they will check the evidence and then act. If they trust, then they will act and, you know, perform the job. If not, they will just opt off. So that's the simpler. Now the bottom left, is a passport model. Let's call this a passport model because that emulates the actual passport system, right? The way the passport works, where I, as a human, I will hold the passport, which is my evidence with myself. Whenever there is a need, I send it to the verifier who can verify the authenticity and tell whether I am trustable, right? Whether I'm a citizen or not, or things like that. So that the relying party can use, right? So very similar to that, in this model, the attester holds the evidence and it sends to the verifier to check the evidence whenever there is a request. And the verifier tests and tells, gives the attestation results to the attester. And then the attester decides whether to give it a right. If it's true, if it's acceptable, if it's trustable, if that cell came up, it can pass it on to the relaying party. So then the relaying party can act upon it, right? So that's the model. This is very useful when there are many multiple relaying parties so that the attester can verify it once and then send the results, attestation results to all the relaying parties, multiple relaying parties, right? This is a useful model if it's that scenario. The bottom right, that's called the background check model. Again, this is also emulated based on how the background check is done, right? Let's say I'm joining a company or getting into a university. I will provide my evidence on what my credentials are. Right? Then the company or the university, they are going to do their background check by sending those things to the verifier and come back and then decide based on that. So it's very similar here. The attester will send the evidence to the relaying party, and then the relaying party will talk to the verifier, get the evidence verified, and then act on it. Right? So these are all different models. Now, depending on how your solution is, how your use case is, you can use a combination of this, right? I can envision where for one specific use, you may be using a simpler, the top one, and then you may use either passport or the background check in a different combination. So a combination of these data flows is also feasible, yeah? So examples of fields that can be evidence that needs to be here. Measurement, which that should be a strong cryptographic fingerprint, hash of the code, that's the initial data from TE, that's a must, right? And the signer, this is basically the identity of the TE developer, the hardware manufacturer, that should be in. The security patching level, this is basically, this could be the version information of the firmware or the components in the TE so that the verifier will know what versions are running here and decide if they are good enough or if that needs to be upgraded before it can be trusted, right? Those kind of decisions can be made. And of course, the TE data. Again, it can be anything, right? You can have many, many, many different fields. I will talk about it in the next slide briefly, what is good to have. At a minimum, right? We suggest that it's a good practice to have the verifier norms and the TE public key as part of the data, right? The TE data. I'll explain why, right? So the verifier norms, that helps in the freshness of the evidence, right? So if it also avoiding any man-in-the-middle attack so that the replay attacks can be avoided, right? So where with the norms, the relying party will know that the evidence is fresh. So that's one useful thing so that the verifier norms should be in as part of TE data. The public key, again, the TE can generate ephemeral public, private key, and then send the public key as part of evidence so that when the relaying party wants to send its sensitive data back to TEE, they can wrap it with the public key so that it's secure when it's in transit. And then the TE can unwrap it with the private key and then use it when it securely use it inside the TE, right? So this is also a good practice. So these are two things that it's good to include in TE data, but you can add any more, right? Depending on your use case and scenarios. So let's look at a combined example. I'll spend a couple of minutes. Yeah. So here's an example on how TEE can be used to protect keys in use, right? Like emulating in HSM basically, right? So in this diagram, it's just a pictorial diagram where you have on the right-hand side, that's the host, or that's a system that has TEE support, right? The top portion of it where you see client application, that is the rich execution environment. It's a normal, regular execution environment. And the bottom portion is the trusted execution environment. That's the TE that we are talking about so far. Yeah. Kyle, let's look at a scenario where the client application needs to either encrypt or decrypt using a key, right? So it needs to get the key. So the way the operation, the flow will happen is the client application is going to issue a call over PKCS11 to the TEE, the crypto library, requesting for the crypto operation, right? You can say, hey, this is the data, encrypt and give, or this is the encrypted data, decrypt and give. That's a sample scenario, right? Now the TEE will generate the evidence, right? And then with the public key, it will send it to the relying party, the red box, right? Now that box, it can be implemented in any of the models that I explained below, right? The background check model or passport model, it's just a black box here, let's assume. Now, that relying party that will verify the evidence, if it passes, if it meets the trust level, then it talks to KMS, gets the key, the wrapped key. Again, you know, you have to make sure that the six is also secure in transit, right? That's the interaction between KMS and relaying party. And then when the relaying party sends the key back to TEE, it's going to wrap it with the TEE's public key and send it back. At this point, all the transit and, you know, in transit and at rest are secure. Now, once the key reaches TEE, from then on, the key never leaves the trusted execution. It just stays there, and then that's decrypted and used as is, right? So in this way, you can see how TEE can emulate a HSM and protect the key while it's being used without giving away. And the client application, in all this scenario, the client application will not have access to the key at all, right? So this is, and like this, we can, you know, we can also talk more about that, about different scenarios, like, you know, the multi-party cloud collaborations and things like that, in terms of Mourad explained how multiple hospitals, if they want to train a machine learning model with the patient data, they can do it when the machine inference model is run in a TEE. The hospitals can still share the patient data through the model, but without exposing to the competing hospital, and still get the benefit out of it. So there are many use cases that can be addressed. So conclusion, so what are the key takeaways? With TEE, with the confidential computing, I think the trust level is amplified, right? And that enables us to confidently run our workloads without worrying about, you know, the other issues. So we can confidently run our workload on a shared compute infrastructure. That's the key benefit. The other benefit, the key takeaway, is many other use cases, you know, healthcare, financial, confidential machine learning, confidential blockchain, and key protection use case that we saw. Many use cases become possible with this confidential computing, right? That's one. The final takeaway is a programmable TEE, right? That with a dedicated hardware that allows us to scale to literally solve any problem, right? Without worrying about the confidentiality. And with very different, keep up to tab on the security level and still deliver the benefit. So with that, I would like to thank RSAC for the opportunity that you gave to talk about this topic, and I will turn back to Casey.
Thank you so much, Jose. Great job, Jose and Mourad. We do have a few questions that came in from the audience. So just, if you have a few moments, we'll go through a couple of those. I know I'll quickly go through. Mourad had answered one, but I'll just pose that for anyone else who is curious. Are there available APIs that unify the programming use of TEE technologies, ARM, TrustZone, Intel SGX, and et cetera? If yes, is there a plan for compilers to automatically integrate such pre-compatibility features? And Mourad recommended to check Open Enclave. Another question, looking at CSPs today, are the raw tools there in all of the big ones to implement these architectures, in your view? Just, are you able to answer that question?
Oh, I was assuming Mourad is going to respond. Let me check. What was the question, Casey?
Sorry, it was looking at CSPs today. Are the raw tools there in all of the big ones to implement these architectures, in your view?
Yeah. My suggestion would be to look at Open Enclave. Open Enclave. That's one standard place where everything is trying to be vendor neutral, the standards are being defined, tools are being planned to be developed as an open source initiative, and that's where we should head towards.
Okay. How would the TEE concept apply to mobile device security for smartphones and tablets?
Again, I can take this question. Again, this is a concept, right? This is a concept, and this is applicable for anything. It doesn't stop with either cloud or edge. So it can be in a client devices, including mobile devices. So when this matures, when there are hardware-based EE available for mobile headsets as well, then this is a solvable solution. Yeah.
Wonderful. And I know that we are at your time limit, so I apologize for going over, and I will go ahead and share these questions with you, the remaining questions with you outside of the webcast, and if we're able to get back to some of our attendees with some responses, we can do that. So thank you so much for joining us today. Listeners, thank you so much for tuning in. If you are interested in more information on cloud computing, to find products and solutions related to cloud security, we invite you to visit rsaconference.com/marketplace. Here you'll find an entire ecosystem of cybersecurity vendors and service providers who can assist with your specific needs. Thank you all so much for joining us today. Take care.
Thank you. Thank you, Casey. Thank you, audience. Have a wonderful day. Bye-bye.
Thank you.